Welcome to the fifth and final session of the ICS-Schiller Institute Conference for the President's Day weekend. This panel tonight is on the topic of the disintegration of the nation-state, and we'll be discussing what Lyndon LaRouche has identified as one of the two dominant and related trends of the current period, the first being the onrushing financial and economic collapse, and secondly, the attack on the nation-state centered out of the financial oligarchy in London. Now, this will be a lot of heavy ideas, a lot of material presented tonight. So now the panel, let me introduce our distinguished panel here tonight. We have Dennis Small, will be speaking on the subject, Saving the Nation State is Child's Play. Dennis Small is the Ibero-American editor of EIR. Following Dennis will be Linda De Hoyos, who is the Africa editor of EIR, speaking on the topic, What Are Our Children and What Are They Doing? Following Linda will be John Hopeful, the EIR economics staff, speaking on the topic, Prosperity for Some, Tragedy for All. And the wind-up speaker will be Jeffrey Steinberg, who can spend the whole time getting wound up. I'm sure he'll wake everybody up at the end. Jeff is the counterintelligence editor of EIR. We'll be speaking on the topic, The Architects of the Assault on the Nation State. So let's begin with Dennis.
Thank you very much. The topic, Saving the Nation State is Child's Play, is not meant to indicate that I think this is going to be easy. Just a few years ago, there were approximately 188 nations in the world. Today, 15 of those countries are gone. Of those 15, about 10 are in Africa. First, transparency. In addition to those 15 countries, which in our view are disappearing, are gone, are finished, there's another 25 or so which are on the chopping block, which you will be able to see on the first chart as soon as it appears on the screen. Whenever that turns out to be. What's going on here is not a case of 15 individual countries that have been individually obliterated. This is not a case of 25 additional countries that are on the chopping block and each for their individual reasons may be about to disappear. It's not a case of 25 countries which may not last out the year because of individual reasons in each specific case. We're talking about a general overall policy directed out of financial interests, centered in London, with branches in New York, in Wall Street, and in many capitals of the world, a policy whose intent, whose purpose, is to replace the nation state as an institution guiding the political destiny of countries, and to replace this with a structure of globalization, of a single global world government in the hands of this financial oligarchy. Their purpose is to create a situation where as the crisis hit, as the crash hits, as the financial disintegration spreads throughout the globe, they will face no problems whatsoever from the institution of the nation state and what this has represented over the course of humanity in terms of opposition to their policies. They intend to control this disintegration. Now, there is a response to this, as you might expect, in different parts of the world. There are people who are quite aware of the fact that it's going and that in some cases, it's gone. For example, the eloquent words of a group of 15 prominent Indonesians who wrote a joint declaration in July of 1998 as their country was in the process of being obliterated by the forces of the IMF and the United Nations and so on and so forth. And in this statement, they said very simply, class conflict could happen, where people with no rice beat up others. We are dying. Do you understand? There are some people around the world who indeed do understand, and I don't think it will be a surprise to those of you here today that many of them, the leaders of political groups, in some cases the leaders of entire nations, are turning to the LaRouche presidential campaign, to the LaRouche movement internationally. They are turning to Lynn in particular, but they are turning to you as the LaRouche movement to make sure that these policies are stopped. The eyes of the world are on LaRouche, and they are on you. And the hopes of the world are with LaRouche, and they are with you and with all of us. And I think that this outlook, this point of view, this responsibility that is resting on our shoulders is very well presented by the former Speaker of the Parliament of Georgia. I don't mean the state, I mean the country. I doubt that the former Speaker of the Parliament of Georgia, the state, would be capable of comments such as this. Certainly not Newt Gingrich. But this is Vakhtang Gurgwadze, who on October 14, 1999, wrote an open letter to the U.S. ambassador to Georgia in which he said the following. And this is representative of what people all around the world are saying. He said, "I am worried about the tragic, almost catastrophic fate of my people. Today, Georgia is in hell. I ask you, Mr. Ambassador, to reconsider the U.S. doctrine of foreign relations and to raise a question at the Department of State about the danger of a boomerang effect resulting from the present ideology. America's current policy is unsuitable for the USA itself. If you desire that people like me should love America, then believe Mr. Lyndon LaRouche. Whether he will become president or not, I do not know. But I know one thing, no future president will be able to ignore his concepts." So we have a world aflame and a world looking to LaRouche, and looking to you and looking to me, to change this situation. Now, the way I want to briefly review this situation of the disintegration of the nation state is to look at this in terms of the effects produced by the 1997 through 1999 wave of financial crises. You know, the last wave of crises that were so successfully resolved, as we've been told. There was the 1997 crisis of Asia, very successfully resolved. It's out of the way, never to return. There was the 1998 crisis of Russia and Eastern Europe, also completely resolved, never to return. And then there was the 1999 crisis in Brazil and the rest of South America. And it too was settled and it was solved, or so we are told. Now, the point is very simple here. The way these crises were solved involved a twofold process. On the one hand, and think back to LaRouche's triple curve function, where you have the two financial curves, the monetary supply curve, and then the financial aggregates above that rising hyperbolically. The way this crisis was quote-unquote solved was by stoking the fires of that speculative financial bubble in each of those situations. And you'll hear a lot more about that from what John has to tell us later this evening. The second side of the solution, quote-unquote, has to do with the lower curve, that is to say, the physical economic parameters, which is the one that has been dropping. And the solution, which this financial oligarchy put into place, involved making sure that that dropped so much faster that nation after nation around the world is being wiped off the face of the earth. That's their solution. The world seen today is strewn with the corpses of once proud nations. And this is the result of the quote-unquote successful resolution of the 1997 through 99 crises. What's going to happen as the next wave of financial crises hit, whenever they may be, tonight, tomorrow, in a month, 2 months. Keep that in mind as you see what has happened so far as a result of the oligarchy's proposed solutions, implemented solutions to this crisis. Now, what they have in mind, what they're doing, what their actual game plan here, is to destroy the nation state. And what I mean by this, I want to get at through a process of discussion. They're talking about actually ripping out that which is the soul of the body politic. I think that's the right way to think about this thing. Now, you'll be hearing more, furthermore, in this panel from Jeff about who are the designers of this policy, who are the architects, what their intention is. I think that you will come away absolutely convinced that this policy is not an error or a mistake or a foolish blunder. It is absolutely intentional. It is being done deliberately. The effects being produced are the intended results of this global financial oligarchy. And you'll hear more about that from Jeff at the later in this panel. But the way this thing has gone about, the way they have approached this, is that they have targeted, for starters, what we can define as three functions, or perhaps pillars, of the nation state. Aspects of the functioning of a nation without which it cannot function as a nation. And those three aspects which I want to focus on are, first of all, the sovereign right of a nation to issue currency. That is to say, to have its own currency, to have its own credit system, to have its own money. A country without a currency is not sovereign. It cannot be a currency. It cannot be a country. This is the case of Panama. Panama is a destroyed country. It doesn't exist. People have seen the currency of Panama. It's called the Balboa. Do people know what a Balboa is? I'll show you one. That's the Balboa. Yeah. This is what circulates in Panama, a dollar. They call it a Balboa, but it's a dollar. They don't have a currency. You can't have a country without a currency. Second function or pillar of a nation state, a viable military. That is to say, an armed forces of a nation to perform the kinds of functions which LaRouche was describing in the question and answer period this afternoon, including defending the existence of that nation state for the purpose of allowing the sovereign development of its economy, of its population, in a concert of nations. And this is very much targeted in this period. It's a second pillar that's under assault. And the third function or pillar of the existing nation state system, which I want to mention, is that of territorial integrity itself. That is to say, the existence of a territory which is that of the nation and which is protected and within the borders of which that economy and that population flourishes and develops. What is under assault now is the very idea that territorial integrity is allowed to exist. You have Kosovo chopped into pieces. You have East Timor. East Timor was stolen from Indonesia. It's very simple. They just stole it. They invaded it with troops from Australia, from the British Commonwealth. So the issue of the actual territorial integrity is a very fundamental question. They use indigenism, they use environmentalism, they use all of these new isms that have been created to fabricate the idea that the territorial integrity should no longer exist, and they proceed on this basis to chop countries into salami, and then to govern it from the top through these global institutions. Very conveniently, of course, they can then proceed with resource grabs to take hold of the oil, of the mineral wealth, and of the other resources that exist under what was previously national sovereign control. Now, the way this thing is done, the thing that really starts to get you angry if you think about how this thing is working, is that the way they have gone about the assault on the currencies and on the military and so on, and to establish these situations, is that this globalized financial oligarchy will pick a target country. It will assault it through the hedge funds. It will deploy George Soros, the world's leading proponent of legalized drugs. They will obliterate its currency. They will reduce it to nothing. They will declare warfare on it. They will annihilate it. And then they'll come in and they say, gee, fellas, you don't seem to have a currency. Would you like to borrow ours? We'll lend you the dollar. You can dollarize. No problem. Same thing with the military, exactly the same thing. They annihilate the national military. They destroy it through budget cutbacks, through international human rights campaigns, through NGOs. They make it incapable of defending itself. For example, in the case of Colombia, which General Bedoya has described for you, and you've heard him speak about before, the Colombian military, properly supported, is perfectly capable of putting an end to the FARC and the ELN narco-terrorist assault, but not if you wipe out their military. And then the really cynical thing is that they come along and they say, gee, guys, you don't seem to be able to handle this. We could send you some blue helmets from the United Nations if you'd like. No problem. And this is the way this game works. I'm always reminded of the, in this procedure, of a little lesson I learned as I was growing up in Mexico, which is the way these type of operations work. You know, you'd park your car in a corner in Mexico, and when you'd come back from going into a store or whatever, all of a sudden you'd discover that the hubcaps are gone. Your four hubcaps are gone. They're stolen. And you figure someone swiped them from you and so on. And as you get in your car and you drive around the corner, right around the corner, there's a guy standing offering you four hubcaps which just happened to fit your car perfectly. And with a big smile on his face, he says, "Señor, I have four hubcaps for you, half the price." You know what's happening, he knows what's happening, but you don't have a choice. And this is the kind of game that they're playing on this question of the military and the currency and so on, although obviously with far, far more serious consequences. Now, I want to review three cases, and I want you to keep in mind these three aspects: the currency, the military, and the territorial integrity. Take a look at the situation of Asia 1997, the Asia crisis of 1997. Next transparency, please. Beginning in the middle of that year of 1997, you had Thailand assaulted, South Korea assaulted, Japan assaulted, and Indonesia, which is the case that we have under review here. The quote-unquote solution to these crises all involved IMF packages involving hundreds of billions of dollars and bone-crunching austerity policies of the IMF, which reduced most of these countries to economic junk heaps. In the case of South Korea and Japan, this crisis dealt a deadly blow to the machine tool capability of those countries in particular, which is of vital importance globally. In the case of Indonesia, which is one of the countries that is on the chopping block and may not be here anymore at the end of this year if we don't do what we have to do, what happened there was an assault on the currency, the rupiah, where you can see here what happened in terms of the devaluation of that currency under this assault. In December 1997, which is where you have the vertical line there, you can see that the rupiah dropped from about 30 cents per 1,000 rupiahs. In other words, with 30 cents, you could buy 1,000 rupiahs. And then, in the process of this financial assault on the country, it dropped down to the level of about 10 cents per 1,000 rupiahs. In other words, this is a two-thirds drop in the value of the currency, which is just completely wiped out. Now, it's very interesting. The thing that happened immediately that this was done, after they'd stolen their hubcaps, after they'd obliterated them, they showed up right around the corner and said, "Hey, we'll offer you another currency. We've got a great currency for you. Why don't you link the rupiah to the dollar? Why don't you set up a currency board, which is just one step shy of full dollarization?" And they attempted to impose a currency board on Indonesia. They failed in that situation. Suharto said no. Johns Hopkins professor Stephen Hanke traveled there. He tried to sell this pitch to them. At that time, both the IMF and Treasury Secretary Robert Rubin did not go with the idea of the currency board. They were opposed to it. So they tried in the case of Indonesia, but they didn't succeed. What they did manage to do, however, as you can see in the next transparency, is that as a result of this financial assault, unemployment in Indonesia soared over the period from 1997 to 1999. It doubled from approximately 4 million to 8 million unemployed in the period of 2 years. And in the next transparency, you can see what has happened to poverty in Indonesia, which had actually been reduced, as you can see, from 1987 to 1992 and then down to 1997, when it was only 11% of the population approximately, maybe 22 million people. And then in a period of 18 months, the number of impoverished people increased over fourfold to 96 million. Now, while the economy was being obliterated in this fashion, the military institution of Indonesia, which was historically essential to its existence as a nation state, with all of its warts, with all of its problems, all of its mistakes, but it was a national institution which helped and still does help hold the country together as a country, was placed under assault. Suharto was toppled in May of 1998, and then a systematic campaign of assault on the military, accusations of human rights violation, charges of thousands being massacred, and so on and so forth proceeded. General Wiranto, the head of the armed forces, was particularly targeted. He was pushed, he was cajoled, and he was then induced, foolishly, to head up the so-called reform process of the Indonesian military. And he made the mistake, the decision, the same mistake I've seen made time and time again in countries in Ibero-America, of figuring that he could better deal with this problem by being involved in it. He decided that it would be better to go along to get along. And he played right into the game, because the strategy of the demilitarizers, the people who want to wipe out this institution, is exactly that: to get rid of the people who are opposed to them, and then use the reformers who helped them make the change and obliterate them as well. And that's what's now happening to Vibranto. Next, transparency. If he had bothered to read EIR, or if he had bothered to read a book called, in Spanish, The Complot, in English, The Plot to Annihilate the Armed Forces and the Nations of Ibero-America, which can be purchased at the bookstore outside and at the literature table, he would have known what people like Samuel Huntington, leading member of the Trilateral Commission, had to say on these type of situations. This is in a book that he wrote called The Third Wave, written in 1992, which is a manual for demilitarization. And Huntington's recommendation is the following: promptly purge or retire all potentially disloyal officers, including both leading supporters of the authoritarian regime and military reformers who may have helped you to bring about the democratic regime. Exact instructions for what has now just happened with General Vibranto, and has happened in country after country. I mean, this is the old story. I may have told it here before, but it's worth telling again. This is one of these universal cases. You know, the old story of how you're supposed to cook a frog. You do not set the water to boil and then try to throw the frog in, because the frog will jump right out of boiling water. If you want to boil a frog and cook a frog, you put him in cool water and you raise the temperature gradually. And at every point, the foolish frog will say, it's getting a little warmer here, but I don't think I'm ready to fight quite yet. And he keeps saying that until he's incapable of doing anything anymore. And that is exactly the means by which institution after institution in countries around the Third World have been obliterated, because they have not understood that what was going on is that the oligarchy was trying to cook them. They figured something else was happening, and that therefore they would stay involved and swim around and see what happened in the situation. Now, of course, the final upshot in the case of Indonesia, as you can see in the next transparency, was a plain old resource grab and fragmentation of the country. What you have here in yellow is the nation of Indonesia, and you have in orange and in red the parts of Indonesia that are being split off from the country by this oligarchical strategy of fomenting ethnic and other problems. The case of East Timor, down towards the bottom, has already occurred. They have lost East Timor. They've lost part of their country. And it just so happens, what a great coincidence and surprise, that there's a huge amount of oil sitting out there in the East Timor Sea, right between Australia and East Timor. And of course, you've got Australian troops sitting in East Timor. Small coincidence, isn't it? Now, the second case study is that of Russia. Next transparency, please. And just to give you a quick idea on this, you've seen some of this before. You've seen what's gone on. From 1990 to 1997, as a result of the Bush-Thatcher policies, Russia was chopped into pieces. Its economy was wrecked, completely destroyed deliberately. You have a situation, these are statistics, incidentally, taken from the book written by Sergei Glasyev, the well-known, the famous economist of Russia, who has published a book called Genocide, which EIR has just translated into English and also is available for purchase outside. These statistics, if we could go back to that transparency, please, I would like people to look at that and see what has happened to consumer good production of a couple of key areas. Meat down 31%, milk down 38% over a 7-8 year period, wages down 52%, and overall agricultural production down 41%. Industry, even worse. Next transparency, please. Look at producer goods. You have, in the case of overall industrial output, down 51% in the 7-year period. And worse still, the most critical areas of industrial output, machinery production and investment in capital goods producing areas have dropped even further. In the case of machinery, by 61%, investment in these areas by 71%. Now, over this period, in the next transparency, you can see that as these real physical economic parameters were in decline, this is your typical collapse function, the triple curve that LaRouche has talked about repeatedly. In the case of Russia, you have agriculture dropping by 41%, industry dropping by 51%, and the debt rising by 225%. Now, but that's just the beginning of the Russia story. The next transparency, you will see what happened when they were placed under assault in 1998. Recall the Indonesian rupiah. This is the case of the Russian ruble, which in August of 1998, before the crash, the assault on the ruble, was valued at approximately 16 cents per ruble or per 1,000 rubles. At first it was 1,000 rubles, then they dropped it to, they knocked off 3 zeros. So 16 cents per ruble. It dropped down to about 5 or 4 cents per ruble. This is a 3/4 reduction or destruction of the value of the national currency of Russia. 2/3 in the case of Indonesia, 3/4 in the case of Russia. Now, lo and behold, after they obliterated their currency, the hubcap swipers showed up in Russia and said, gee, we'll offer you a currency. Why don't you set up a currency board? Link your currency to the dollar. That'll bring stability. And they sent over Domingo Cavallo, who had brought this about in Argentina. The whole Gore crowd was deployed. Chernomyrdin, they actually tried to get Russia to dollarize, to set up a currency board. And fortunately in that situation, as with Indonesia, it did not work. It failed in that occasion. It must be mentioned that at this point there was a political and economic interlude of great significance in the case of Russia, which is that the Primakov government came in from September 98 to May of 99, which was a total change in the general directionality of this triple collapse function that we saw before. Because on the one hand, the physical economic parameters began to rise, and on the other hand, the debt was actually reduced. And the Primakov government was eventually knocked out, among others, by the Gore administration. Vice President Gore effectively is the one who stopped Primakov's plane in midair so that Primakov couldn't come and meet with Clinton. So that needs to be said. What's happening now in Russia is, again, the issue of the actual territorial integrity of the country is what's at stake. This Chechenya revolt, which is going on, and the whole manipulation of this crisis to sink Russia into a losing scenario. It's a lose-lose scenario, the way this thing is set up, the way the Russians are responding to this thing, where they are having pieces of their national territory chopped off right in front of them, which is, of course, a fast track to a war, among other things. But the actual territorial integrity of Russia is not only at stake, but it's actually being affected right now as we're discussing. No great surprise, perhaps, that under these circumstances, you have patriots of Russia also turning to LaRouche, also turning to this presidential campaign as the only hope, as the only answer to this situation. And let me quote a paragraph from a recent statement which was issued by a group of about 15 or so top scientists and intellectuals in Russia, including such people as Ruslan Khasbulatov, the former chairman of the Supreme Soviet and a very famous physicist in the country, Nina Gromyko, the editor-in-chief of the Russian Analytical Review, a doctor of philosophical sciences, Leonid Shelepin, the chief scientist of the Institute of Physics, and others. What do these people have to say about LaRouche in light of what's happening to their country? I mean, put yourself in their shoes and in their mind. Look at the world through their eyes. And what do they see when they look at the United States and the LaRouche campaign? This is what they see. They say, with great interest and agitation, we are following the presidential campaign in the United States and your own participation in it. Through personal contacts and acquaintances with your scientific writings and political speeches, we have gotten to know your profound erudition, the precision of your analysis, your sharp mind, your intolerance of phoniness, your high level of scientific honesty, and your ability to put forward original ideas and find constructive, sometimes unexpected solutions and recommendations. Like no one before, you have succeeded in uncovering the harmony and interaction of rigorous science and classical art forms, as well as uniting the methods of scientific discovery and the education of youth. We think that you, Mr. LaRouche, are the one capable of directing your country onto the path of progress and prosperity for the American people and for the sake of all the people of our planet. We hope that American voters will make the right choice by voting for you as the future President of the United States. Now let's turn to our third case study, that of South America, and in particular the situation of Ecuador. This is the 1999 crisis, which was so beautifully resolved by these guys. Next, transparency. The case of Ecuador and the sucre, their currency. Again, exactly the same thing as Indonesia, exactly the same thing in Russia. In March of 1999, the sucre was assaulted, you can see right there, and it was set to float, and its value dropped from about 10,000 to the dollar to 18,000 to the dollar. A few months later, down the jagged curve there, you can see, in September, they defaulted on their foreign debt obligations. They simply could not pay. That is to say, they went bankrupt. And by the beginning of this year, in December and then in early January, the value of the sucre had dropped to 25,000 to the dollar, starting off at the level of 10,000, dropping to 25,000. Stated in inverse terms, 14 cents back in January would buy you 1,000 sucres. It dropped to 4 cents to buy 1,000 sucres. This is a two-thirds drop in the value. Now, on January 9th, remember what happened in Indonesia and what happened in Russia. The big push went on, get a currency board, go with a dollar. Have we got some hubcaps to sell you? Well, it didn't work in Indonesia, and it didn't work in Russia. But it worked in Ecuador. And it's extremely significant that it worked in Ecuador. Not because of Ecuador itself, but because of what this means for the policy direction of the globe. Ecuador, on January 9th of the year 2000, chose to dollarize. That is to say, they chose to accept the dollar as their currency. Now, that sounds great. What's wrong with a dollar? Everyone wants to have dollars, right? Sounds pretty good. Motherhood, apple pie, dollars, what could be better? What does it really mean? Let's look at this question of dollarization. Okay, next, transparency. Over the course of the destruction of the sucre in 1999, this is just what happened in 1999 in Ecuador, the economic collapse was the following. The productive capacity in the country dropped by 40%. It wiped out almost half of the productive capacity of the country. Okay. Total imports dropped by 50%. Why? Because their currency wasn't worth anything anymore. They couldn't import anything. Food, medicine, pharmaceuticals. The minimum wage in the country dropped 67% in 1 year. Well, what does the year 2000 bring? Next, transparency. What's happening as a result of inflation and this dollarization process, as you can see in the next transparency, is that the cost of medicine, in January alone, this is in 1 month in Ecuador, the cost of medicine, basic medical supplies, has risen by 40%. The cost of rice, a staple food item, has risen by 43%. That's in 1 month. The cost of cooking oil in the Sierra, in the mountain regions, has risen by 150% in 1 month. Now, what do you think this is doing to the standard of living of the population? Next, transparency, please. You can see what has happened in terms of the ability of the population to purchase a minimal market basket of consumption. 53% of the population, these are official statistics, by the way, so the reality is far worse. 53% of the population can purchase a minimal market basket of consumer items. 24% of the population are only able to purchase what is called a poverty basket. They're poor. The only thing they can get is a poverty basket. 23% can't even get that. Next, transparency. Slavery. You heard LaRouche say that dollarization means slavery. Well, take a look at slave labor. In 1999, in Ecuador, the minimum wage for a day's labor, this is a day, this is not per hour, per day, was $6 per hour, per day, excuse me. Now, in dollar equivalent, the year 2000, as a result of this policy of dollarization, the minimum wage per day is $2 per day. 20% of the workforce of Ecuador earns a dollar or less per day. And day laborers, especially in the countryside, earn an average of 35 cents a day. That's slavery. The banking system is gone. Next transparency. The banking system is completely obliterated. You have approximately two-thirds of the banks that have basically gone bankrupt already. This is total dollar value. You can see the lower part red is the part that's closed completely. The middle area has been seized by the government, and they're trying to keep them afloat. They're going to go as well. Only the top third, more or less, is actually open and functioning at this point. As usual, the IMF comes in with its helpful, insistent recommendations. End all subsidy on prices. Raise prices of utilities, of oil, of basic consumption items to so-called international levels, which means they zoom up to the sky. Wage levels should be reduced, and everything in the country should be privatized. Now, this dollarization question, look, let's just cut to the quick on this thing. What is dollarization? Dollarization for a country like Ecuador, or a country like Russia, or a country like Indonesia, dollarization is a form of bankruptcy reorganization of the country. That's what it is. They're bankrupt, their currency doesn't work anymore, it's been obliterated, and they're going to reorganize the country by dollarizing. Okay. LaRouche talks about bankruptcy reorganization too, doesn't he? What is the content of the bankruptcy reorganization? Ecuador has approximately $800 million in its foreign reserves, liquid reserves. That barely covers the current money supply in sucres. In other words, you take the sucres out of circulation and you put in the dollars. Okay. What about the entire banking system, the deposits? What about the domestic credit structure? What about lending to business? What about lending to consumers? It all gets completely wiped out. And what's maintained is the foreign debt structure, possibly with an IMF loan, and the absolute minimal level in terms of the money supply. In other words, it is a bankruptcy reorganization, except what you do is you salvage the parasite, the cancer, and obliterate what the functioning economy is. You read financial columns about Ecuador and they say, well, gee, it's really too bad. It looks like the domestic credit system is going to have to take the hit to keep the foreign side of the bubble afloat. So what you have with dollarization is the exact flip side of what LaRouche has said in every occasion must be done. What's the bankruptcy reorganization? You take the 9/10 of the financial instruments that reflect nothing but cancer, and you wipe them out. See you later. And you defend the actual remaining 10% of actual banking structure, which works, which is for use, which is for communities, which is businesses, neighborhoods, and so on. So dollarization is actually the exact opposite of the LaRouche proposal. So it's slavery, but it's one thing else. Where is Ecuador going to get its dollars from? Alan Greenspan? I mean, have you stopped to think about that? Where are they going to get their dollars? Well, okay, by what they export. Would you like to know what Ecuador exports? Good, I'm glad you want to know, because I'm going to tell you. Ecuador exports oil. That's 30% of their exports. Right now they're doing okay. 2 years ago they wouldn't have made a penny from that, and 2 weeks from now they may not make a penny from it if the price plummets. Bananas, that's 26%. And shrimp, that's another 16%. 72% of their foreign exchange earnings comes from three products. So in Ecuador, what they're talking about is maintaining the flow of dollars into the country in an unpredictable world environment by taking the few dollars that they have and placing them in the futures market. That's true. That's what they're talking about doing. They're going to speculate with the foreign reserves that they have, the little that they have, to hopefully have some sort of money supply. Well, there's something else that they're going to do. This is going to legalize the drug trade in Ecuador. They're going to get drug dollars. Take a look at the next map. Where is Ecuador, after all? The exploding part of this map is the FARC-controlled area of Colombia. Colombia is taken over by this process. Venezuela, it's the same thing that's going on. Chavez is completely allied with the FARC in Colombia. This has effectively moved in and taken over Panama. In the case of Ecuador, there's a tremendous influence of the FARC and people who are also trying to ally with Chavez. In this situation, with no dollars, with no capability of maintaining their economy, where do you think the dollars for Ecuador are going to come from? Shrimp? Forget it. This is going to legalize the drug trade. That's where they're going to get their dollars from. So dollarization doesn't mean only slavery. It means drugs, which is a different form of slavery. Same idea. And this is what's going on. Now, just to finish out this idea of this drug economy question, in the next transparency, I just want to give you a little bit of a preview of what this is. You've all seen this. This is the Grasso abrazo, the hug of Grasso. Grasso is the guy on the, let's see, which one is he? He's the one who looks fatigued. So that's Grasso, the president of the New York Stock Exchange, and this is Comandante Raul Reyes, the chief of finances of the FARC, carrying the instruments of his trade, currently on a tour of Europe. Now, in addition to this, what's going on, as you can see in the next transparency, is that the Pastrana government, in order to bring about peace, has decided that not only should they hand over one area of the country, which is the area in red below, to the FARC, which they've done, but they're now handing over a second area, which is the red area on the top, to the ELN. That's the other cartel. General Bedoya calls them the fourth cartel. The FARC is the third cartel. The ELN is the fourth cartel. So this thing is spreading. That's what's actually happening in this situation. Put yourself in the shoes of the patriots of these countries, as we did a moment ago for Russia or for Georgia. How do these people look at the United States? Well, you've heard what General Bedoya had to say. You've heard how and why he's endorsed the LaRouche presidential campaign. Consider the case of the former presidential candidate of Brazil, Dr. Enéas Carneiro. He endorsed LaRouche in the following terms. He said, "Mr. LaRouche is unrelenting in his fight for the welfare of all people. And I believe that through this year's presidential elections in the United States, only he can make possible and worthwhile the productive work that will defeat speculation. We shall see wisdom and organization directed against ignorance and the chaos. It will be the light against the darkness." And then, of course, the statement which you may be familiar with of the former president of Mexico, José López Portillo, who is one of the leading patriots of the last 20 or 30 years of Mexico, who, in addition to meeting with Helga recently and giving a joint presentation with her, has issued an endorsement, a ringing endorsement of LaRouche, in which he says, "In the battle for such a new world order, I would like to recognize the tireless and generous efforts carried out by Lyndon H. LaRouche, for whom I hope for the best as a pre-candidate for the presidency of the United States of America. I wish that his voice be listened to and followed by those in the world who have the grave responsibility of stopping this situation from continuing on its calamitous course. And I hope that his fellow U.S. citizens, who will elect their president in the coming elections, will give him their timely recognition and support." Now, all of this, what we've seen, these three factors or pillars of the nation state that we've reviewed, in one sense is really not the core of the matter. Currency, the military, territorial integrity, these are kind of the attributes of the body politic in one sense. The question is, in addition to these necessary conditions for a nation state, because they are necessary, but they're not sufficient. There's more to a nation state than currency, military, territorial integrity. After all, the British Empire, right? It has a currency, it has military, right? It has a territorial integrity. So those three attributes do not a nation state make. There's something more. There's something that actually is the guts of it. There's something that's the soul of the nation state. It's that intangible idea, but which is the actual life force of this institution which we call the nation state. And I think it has to be looked at in exactly this fashion, from the standpoint which Kuza, for example, if you'll show the next transparency, discusses the role that the soul plays, or what the soul actually is, or the mind, which in this case, in Kuz, are interchangeable. This is from his dialogue, The Layman About Mind of 1450, where he says, "Mind is a living substance. Its function in this body is to give it life. And because of this, it is called soul. Mind is a substantial form of power." Now, what is that that concept, that intangible soul, that idea which makes the nation state the nation state. And this, I think, is the core of the matter. The nation state is the only institution, the only form of organization of society which is perfectly attuned to that which is distinctly human about the human being. That is to say, that cognitive capability to make breakthroughs in discovery, which is the actual proof of the existence of the human soul. It is the vehicle through which the general welfare can be achieved. It is the only vehicle through which the general welfare can be achieved. It is a way of bringing about the common good. It is the way in which a society organizes itself politically to achieve these goals. And it is the form of organization of a society, and the only one, and in this sense a crucial creation, or discovery, which fosters the existence of the kind of individual which can make this process actually work, who finds joy in cognition, whose identity is in that process of discovery. And it is a process which we see most clearly, in fact, in children. In children. You know, people talk a lot about imago Dei, imago viva Dei, that man is made in the living image of God. And sometimes you wonder, you look around at your fellow man and you say, well, I don't know. I suppose it's true. But look at children. Why was Helga's presentation so upsetting and so disturbing? It's not just that there was blood and gore and all the rest of it. That's not the problem. The problem is that it's children that we're talking about here. And in children, we see most clearly expressed exactly that which is imago viva Dei. Think of this as children made in the living image of God. And what happens to a child developing in one direction or another that changes that, that affects that situation? You'll hear more about this issue of the children today from Linda. You know, people often say, you know a society by how it treats its old people or how it treats its prisoners. That's true. That's true. But I think that it's equally true that you know a society by how it treats its children and what it does. Now, I want to go into this issue as the soul of the nation state by looking at the question of this joyous creative process in children. And I want to talk very briefly about a couple of dialogues of Plato's. And in particular, I want to talk about the Meno, because to my knowledge, this is the only dialogue of Plato where a child appears. I mean, not just appears, but actually participates in the dialogue. There's many interesting things about the Meno. It's not my intent to review that systematically. This is the slave boy in the Meno dialogue, and I'll refresh your memory on this, and so on. But the interesting question is that this is a child. Now, let's look at how Plato addresses this question. Now, there's a couple of participants in this dialogue, in addition to Socrates. You have Meno himself. And Plato sets the stage for what is going to happen with the slave boy, with the child, by first showing the discussion between Socrates and Meno. Meno is a young guy. He's a nobleman. He's sort of your typical blocked person who you're trying to organize. So it includes Meno, it includes the child, and it closes with Anytos. Now, Anytos is very interesting. He turns out to be one of the three accusers of Socrates in the trial, various dialogues down the line. Keep that in mind. So it's your typical organizing situation. You got three personality types that you're dealing with here. Okay? You run across them, just as Socrates did. So Socrates begins the discussion with Meno, the nobleman, by saying, okay, well, let's discuss what is virtue. What is virtue and can it be taught? So Meno says, well, that's fine. I'll tell you what virtue is, and then he describes the different kinds of virtue that exist. There's virtue in men, and there's virtue in women, and there's virtue in children, and there's this, that, and the other. And Socrates finally interrupts him and says, no, don't give me a swarm of different definitions. I don't want a swarm. I don't want a multitude. I want to know what the common element of all of this is. What is virtue itself? Not all of the different expressions of virtue. So Meno says, okay, I understand what you want. Well, in that case, I would say that virtue is to desire handsome things and to have the power to achieve them. Okay, so Socrates says, well, let's explore that a little bit. And he says, well, if you're saying that it's what desiring handsome things, do you really think that some people desire bad things? And then he proceeds to discuss this with him. How could anyone desire something bad? Isn't it a case of someone actually not knowing what it is that he is desiring, which leads him to desire something bad? And he goes through it in this fashion and demonstrates to Meno that it couldn't possibly be anything of this sort, and that he was effectively laying out a circular argument by simply saying that virtue is a whole series of different acts that are done, but each performed with a certain amount of virtue. So Socrates says to him, don't tell me that virtue are acts performed with virtue. You've told me nothing whatsoever. And then something very interesting happens. Meno says to him the following. He says, Socrates, I don't know what you've done. You're a wizard. I'm numb. My mind has stopped working. I can't speak. I don't know what's going on. And I'll quote it for you. He says, this is Meno speaking, answering Socrates. He says, and now you seem to me to be a regular wizard. You dose me with drugs and bewitch me with charms and spells and drown me in puzzledom. I'll tell you just what you're like, if you will forgive a little jest. Your looks and the rest of you are exactly like a flatfish, and you sting like this stingray. Only go near and touch one of those fish, and you go numb. And that is the sort of thing you seem to have done to me. Really and truly, my soul is numb, and my mouth is numb. And what to answer you, I do not know. And then, an interesting little warning, he says to Socrates, I must say, you are wise not to sail away or travel abroad. For if you did this as a foreigner in a foreign city, you would probably be run in for a wizard. So Socrates said to him, well, you know, there's no reason to be numb about this. I myself don't really know the answer to this, and it's something we don't have the answer to, so let's go about and find the answer. And Meno geeks out. He says, what do you mean? How can we find the answer and look for something if we don't know what we're looking for? But if we know what we're looking for, why should we look for it? Right? He says, Meno says, and how will you try to find out something, Socrates, when you have no notion at all what it is? Will you lay out before us a thing you don't know and then try to find it? Or if at best you meet it by chance, how will you know this is that which you did not know? So Socrates says to him, my dear friend Meno, I understand what you wish to say, Meno. You look on this as a piece of chop logic. Don't you see, as if a man cannot try to find either what he knows or what he does not know? And Meno somewhat sheepishly says, then you don't think that this is a good argument, Socrates? And Socrates says, no, I do not. So that's his dealing with Meno. Now that's important to lay the stage for what comes next. I mean, you can certainly recognize this type of discussion, which you've probably had a million times in trying to organize people. Now, then he raises the question he has the discussion with a slave boy. He tells Meno, bring your slave here, your slave boy, this child, and I'm going to show you something about how people learn what they know, not simply repeating by rote, but actually what he calls remembrance. They remember things that they know. They create knowledge for themselves and thereby remember it. This is Plato's famous doctrine of remembrance. This is not the idea of rote memorization of past information. That is not the idea at all. I refer you on this issue to LaRouche's documents on the subject of memory in motivic thorough composition, the role of memory in music in particular, because that's the idea that Plato is getting at here. I mean, what he actually says, I think I have a transparency on this, on the question of what he means by memory and remembrance is the following. Next slide, please. Plato says, he will know, having got the knowledge out of himself. To get knowledge out of yourself is to remember. Right? In other words, it's not transference of information. That's not what we're dealing with here. And he says, I'm going to show you what I'm talking about in the case of this young child. Now, I'm going to go through this fairly quickly, and I don't want you to focus a whole lot in terms of the specific predicates of the geometry involved and so on. Look at the thought process of the child, and remember what we're trying to get at here, the issue of the soul of the nation state, what it is that holds it together. Now, and this is a three-step process that goes on in the Meno, as Plato reviews it through Socrates. the important question here is to look at how the child is thinking. Don't look at the specific thoughts. Look at how he's thinking about this. Now, in the first step, if we can have the next transparency, is a level of sort of simple knowledge, where what Socrates lays out to this young child in the first square on the left, he says, okay, you recognize this square here. This is, we can count out 2 units in one direction and 2 units in the other. And he asks him, therefore, what would the area of the whole thing be? And he counts it and he says, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so the area of this is 4. And then he asks him to indicate what he thinks, how you would produce an area twice the size of the first square. Simple enough question. And this young child begins by thinking that he knows exactly what the solution is. And he says very quickly, oh, well, it's obvious. You draw a square which has a side which is twice as long. It's an obvious answer. It's sort of obviously true on the surface of it. You just double the side on the thing. And in the process of the discussion with Socrates on this, at this level of simple knowledge, he sees his own error after having jumped into this feet first. And the dialogue goes something like this, just to, again, to get an idea of how this the thought process going on here with a child. Socrates says, well, could there be another such space as the first one there on the left, but twice as big, but of the same shape with all the lines equal like this one? And the boy says, yes. And Socrates says, well, how many feet will there be in that then? And the boy, knowing that there's 4 in the first one and the other one has to be double, he says, well, 8. And Socrates says, okay, very well. Now try to tell me how long will be each line of that one. The line of this one is 2 feet. How long would be the line of the double one be? And the boy says, completely self-assured, the line would be double, Socrates. That is clear. Okay, and then Socrates proceeds on this question so that he sees his own error. And he says, well, then if we put 4 like this, and this is the second square, the second diagram there, if we put 4 squares together, you say we shall get the 8-foot space. And the boy says, yes, still quite confident. And Socrates says, well, then let us draw these 4 equal lines. Is that the space which you say will be 8 feet? And the boy says, of course. And Socrates says, well, how big is the new one, which we just drew? Is it not 4 times the old one? And the boy says, well, surely it is. And Socrates says, is 4 times the old one double? And the boy says, well, no, upon my word. And Socrates says, well, how big is it then? He says, it's 4 times as big. Socrates says, then, my boy, from a double line, we get a space 4 times as big, not double. And the child, puzzled, says, that's true. Notice the difference in, pardon the editorializing here, notice the difference in attitude of the boy and Mino, his master, to new knowledge, new information. The kid is puzzled but very curious. He wants to know how to proceed on this thing. So then Socrates leads him on in the next step. And he says, well, okay, let's come up with an idea of what else it might be. I need to go back to that same diagram, please. Now, the attitude of the boy in this stage of the thing is very cautious on the one hand, because he knows that he made a mistake by jumping in feet first, but he's also daring still. He's willing to be cautious, knowing that he made a mistake, but he's also daring in the sense that he's willing to try out new ideas. And he comes up with something which is flat out wrong, of course, on this, because what Socrates says to him is, well, okay, it's clearly more than the 2 by 2, which was the first square, because that produced 4, an area of 4, but we just said that it's not 2 by 2, because that produces an area of 16, so it's between a side of 2 and a side of 4. What do you think it is? And the boy says, well, it's probably 3 then. Right? Socrates says, then the line of the 8-foot space must be longer than this line of 2 feet and shorter than the line of 4 feet. And the boy says, yes, it must. And Socrates says, well, try to tell me then how long you say it must be. And the boy says, 3 feet. Socrates says, then if the space is 3 feet this way and 3 feet that way, the whole space will be 3 times 3 feet. And the boy, getting some idea of where this is all heading, says, well, it looks like it. And Socrates says, well, how much is 3 times 3 feet? He says, 9. Socrates says, well, how many feet was the double to be? He says, 8. Socrates says, so we have not got the 8-foot space from the three-feet line after all. The boy says, no, we haven't. And Socrates says, well, then how long ought the line to be? Try to tell us exactly, or if you don't want to give it in numbers, show it if you can. And the boy says, indeed, Socrates, on my word, I don't know. Very interesting. First time around, he knew, except he was wrong. Now he doesn't know, but he's highly inquisitive. He wants to try to figure out how to do this. And the next step in the dialogue is, of course, the interesting one, where Socrates prompts him to come up with an idea of how to actually solve this thing. And he, at first, the child doesn't see it. He doesn't recognize it in the next transparency. And then when he actually sees it, you have a transformation in his mind where he is confident. The color didn't come out on this one at all. Okay. What Socrates proposes and what he does is he says, well, let's draw a line which is a diagonal across the first square A, and then another one across B, and another one across D, and another one across C. And then what happens? And Socrates says, well, then here is a line running from corner to corner, cutting each of these spaces in two parts. Each of the squares gets cut in two parts. And the boy says, yes. And Socrates says, are not these four lines equal, and don't they contain the space within them? And the boy says, yes, that's right. And then Socrates says, well, just consider, how big is the space? And the boy says, I don't understand. So Socrates comes back at it again. He says, well, does not each of these lines cut each of the spaces, four spaces, in half? Is that right? And he says, yes. Well, how many spaces as big as that are in this middle space that he's just drawn with these diagonals? Okay, how many spaces are there in there? He says, well, there's four of them. Right? And how many were there in the original one, A, that he just cut in half? He says, two. How many times two is four? He says, well, it's twice four, two. So then Socrates says, well, how many square feet big is in this middle space? And the boy says, it's 8 square feet. And then Socrates says, the professors call this a diameter or a diagonal. So if this is a diagonal, the double space would be made from the diagonal, as you say, Meno's boy. And the child says, certainly, Socrates. So this time he's confident of the idea because he has developed it himself. He has developed it himself. And you see a process of change in the way he's approached this, which is completely different from what we saw before with Meno, who was dealing with this in terms of chop logic, to quote Socrates on this question, and very different from what happens next in the dialogue, which is really quite significant. Because when all this has happened, in walks Anytos. And Socrates, of course, tries to pull him into the middle of the discussion. And he says, well, we've discussed this, we've discussed that, and we found, lo and behold, Anytos, that virtue cannot be taught. This is a very interesting thing that we've discovered and so on. The first words out of Anytos' mouth on this issue, when raised this way, is, my dear Socrates, you seem to speak ill of men easily. I would advise you to be careful, if you will listen to me. Perhaps it is easier to do people harm than good in other cities, but it is very easy in this. I think you yourself knew that perfectly well. And he stomps off. He leaves. And Socrates says, well, Meno, I'm afraid that Anytos is angry. And I don't wonder, for he thinks, firstly, that I am defaming these men, and secondly, he believes he is one of them himself. And this is, of course, one of the guys who turns out to be Socrates' accusers in one of the later dialogues. I mean, you've run across people like this. The second you throw an idea out to them, they get angry, they stomp off, they accuse you, you know, why you pinky Platonist you, or you sissy Socratic. Why don't you go back to where you came from, Greece, you know, something like that. But you've run across this all the time. And this is the kind of environment that we're dealing with when we're trying to bring out in people what is otherwise found in this slave boy and this child. It's, I think, one of the unique things in Plato, precisely because he's addressing the issue of a child developing these ideas. You can find the same thing in another dialogue, which I will not review for you, but in the Theaetetus in particular, which is the subtitle of the Theaetetus, is on knowledge. It's a very interesting dialogue because it's a young man, it's not a child, it's a young man by the name of Theaetetus, who from the outset is described as being like Socrates. He's like Socrates. It's done in a funny way. Theodorus says, "I have met a fine young Athenian, Socrates, and it will pay you to listen while I describe him. Actually, so far from being handsome, forgive my saying so, he is rather like you, what with his snub nose and protruding eyes, though these features are less noticeable in him than in you. So I can speak without fear. I assure you that among all the young men whom I have met, and I have come across a great many, I have never found one of such extraordinary promise." And the remainder of the dialogue, the discussion, is a process of Socrates leading Theaetetus to joyous new discoveries along the stage of figuring out what knowledge is not, because it is never stated there in any positive, explicit sense what it supposedly is. And many people have protested mightily, why didn't Plato state what his theory was? People don't understand how Plato was going at it. He develops a process of thinking through mistakes in previous hypotheses. And the joy with which Theaetetus goes at this is similar only to that of the Meno, of the child in the Meno. And all of the specific definitions that Theaetetus comes up with are wrong. Every single one is wrong. But Socrates is elated. He's ecstatic with Theaetetus because he's thinking it through. And at the end, he says precisely that to him. Now, I wanted to mention this to you. I wanted to give you a sense of this discussion way back when, from the classical period of Greece, of exactly this issue of cognition in children in particular, because I believe this is really at the very heart of what we're talking about with the defense of the nation state, with the disintegration of the nation state by the enemy, and what they are really trying to destroy. Oh, sure, they have to get rid of its attributes. They have to get rid of the currencies, the military, the territorial disintegration. But what they are really trying to destroy is this process of thinking like children excited with new discoveries and not attached to any particular old ideas. This is what they are trying to kill. And I think that if we are to take the Minos of this world, the chop logic block noblemen and others, what we have to do is we have to turn them effectively into slave boys making new discoveries. And in that sense, I think that saving the nation state is in fact child's play. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dennis. To repeat the announcement from earlier on tomorrow for the internal conference, that all guests must re-register in the morning beginning at 10 a.m. The internal conference, the business meeting, will convene at 11 a.m. and all regions should provide an organizer and a guest list tomorrow morning for that registration at 10 a.m. Our next speaker is Linda De Hoyos, who is the Africa editor of EIR. She is one of the authors of the package in the recent issue of EIR. This is the February 18th issue, The Nation States Disintegrate Under Assault from London. And this, as many other back issues of EIR, are available at the literature table in the back. Linda's topic is, where are our children? What are they doing? Linda.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank the people who helped me pull this together on very short notice, which includes Richard Freeman and Joe Bruda, and the graphics people who do this computerized graphics, Claude Jones and George Hollis and John Hofel, without which I wouldn't be able to answer, at least in part, this question. So the question poses, where are our children and what are they doing? And I want to look at this in a preliminary way by telling a very quick story. In 1967, when I was in high school, I ran for treasurer of student council. And my opponent was a lot more popular than I was, and he was expected to win. But I won the election based on a speech that I gave that my father had helped me to write, which was something like this. Well, you know, anybody can balance the books, but I have ideas. Like, we as a school could help build a school in Africa for children there. And this excited everybody, and after the speech, my opponent came up and said, you know, you won the election. And I did win. And unfortunately, we did not build that school, and I did spend a lot of time trying to figure out the books. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is because of the reaction of the student body to such a proposal, which stood in stark contrast to what happened in 1975 when I was asked to address a high school in Darien, Connecticut, in, you know, a suburban neighborhood quite like my own, and to brief them on LaRouche's programs and policies for the world. And I did this, I gave a presentation on the IDB and turning long-term debt into, returning debt into long-term credits for the purposes of global development. And the response was not an argument that this is impossible or arguing with the problem. The response was, why should we do that? And I was very shocked at this. And I thought, what in the world has happened? Because they were saying that we don't care. This is not an issue for us. Now, when I tried to think of what had happened in between, of course, it was a lot. Could I have the first slide? First of all, even back in 1967, we were still excited about the space program, and that we had a sense that we were expected to achieve, and that this achievement would be a contribution to our country, which was forging ahead. That was the legacy of President Kennedy to us back then. Next. We were also excited about the Peace Corps, and this is a picture of President Kennedy greeting Peace Corps volunteers. My next door neighbor was a Peace Corps volunteer. We were interviewed by the federal government as to her moral qualities. And here is Michael Billington, which most of you know, and he was a Peace Corps volunteer, for example, as were others of us. And the idea was not, the significance of this is not the program itself, but the sense that was given that we, as Americans, had a responsibility to develop the rest of the world and to help bring them up to out of backwardness and up to our own levels, and that this was our personal responsibility. We were also a generation that was still inspired by the greatness of Martin Luther King. But by 1975, I was shocked to learn that all this had basically died. And as a result of the tumult of the Vietnam War, the sex, rock, drug counterculture, the successive assassinations of our best leaders, and the spread of a rabid kind of environmentalism. And so by 1975, a challenge that was similar to what I had posed to students in 1967 was met with a response of extreme selfishness and profound cynicism. Since the powers that be have said that the United States must abandon its mission, then what is the rest of the world to me? And since the rest of the world is nothing to me, then why should I know anything about it? It's better to be clueless. And it is this selfishness and cynicism that has nearly brought about the total destruction of our country. And I want to now look at the results of that destruction in the world as a whole. So next. So the question is, where are children and what are they doing? I want to do this by just going over a survey of this from a global standpoint. Next. Can't hear me? Can't hear me? Okay, here's the children the way we like to see them, happy. There are 2,114,291,000 plus children in the world today. Next, here's happy kids in the snow, same thing. Next. Now, the first thing that's happening to children is that they're having difficulties getting born. And you can see this in the fact, in a very simple way, that the proportion of the global population, which is under 18 years of age, is shrinking in every continent on the globe. And the least in Africa, and you can see that there, the greatest degrees by the continents. Next. This is the crude birth rate in 1970 and 1998. So basically, in the simplest, darkest way, the cynicism within us is being expressed in our doubts of the future and in our reluctance to have children at all. Next. Aside from having difficulties being born, children are dying. At least 11,140,000 children under the age of 5 will die this year. And if it were not for a global vaccination campaign by UNICEF beginning, I think, in the mid-1980s, this figure would be far higher, I'm sure. But we see here concretely what this means, what the lack of development means for children. Only 60,000 of those 11 million plus children who will die live in OECD countries, which is the norm that should exist for everywhere in the world. 225,000 will die in the former territories of the Soviet Union. 425,000 will die in Ibero-America. Next. 613,000 of these dying children live in Mideast and North Africa, but 4 million of them live in Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, and another 5 million of them live in Asia. Next. Here is the graph of the under 5 mortality rate for the world. And you know, you can see that basically all this is completely unnecessary. Now, next, what kills children? These are the countries in which under 5 mortality is over 20%. That is to say that out of every 10 children born and who survive birth or living births, that 2 of them will die. In Sierra Leone, it's nearly 3 children out of every 10. And you can see the major killer is countries which are at war, which is all the countries which are starved. But aside from that, we see Niger, Mali, the big countries of the Sahel, and Malawi, where there is just simply, absolutely no development whatsoever. There's just nothing in these countries. What are the causes of death? Next. Diarrhea will kill 19% of these children. And this is a very simple thing. Diarrhea means no clean water. So that is a simple lack of infrastructural development. Most of the rest will die of diseases which have basically been wiped out elsewhere. There are two problems here. First is that children who do not receive medical attention, doctors and medicine, die, whereas in the industrialized countries, when a child contracts the same disease, that child will generally live. And in fact, their lives will never be in danger. So that's the lack of medical services, which has been made grossly worse by the policies of the International Monetary Fund in particular. The second problem is that half the children in the underdeveloped world are hungry, and they are malnourished. And therefore, when a disease afflicts them, they have no resistance to it, and they die far more quickly than a child in the industrialized sector might. Okay, next. Okay, now what are they doing? There are 1.6 million children of, billion, I'm sorry, children of school age, and we think they should all be in school. Next. The assumption is, here's we see children in the United States going to school. Next. The assumption is, here's a school in, it looks like a Horn of Africa country. The assumption is that any child who is able to learn to read and who may have access to books and to information has the capability of seeing beyond their own physical existence, day-to-day physical existence. In other words, an entire universe is opened up to them. right? And conversely, any child who cannot be, who does not know how to read, is basically being thrown on the scrap heap. His humanity is not destroyed, but his potential as a human being is being trashed. His God-given right to develop his potentials to the fullest extent are being denied. Nearly 400 million children out of the total school-age population globally are not in school. 250 million of these children work. This is the number of children who are not simply helping out on the farm or the homestead, but are relied upon to bring in income into the family, or who must work in order to get their own food every day. Okay, next. This just shows the number of children that are basically being denied the right of their development. This is the 24%. Okay, now what does the world of working children look like? This is a carpet weaver in Nepal, and she is a tired child. In India and Nepal, there are approximately 100 to 300,000 children who work as bonded laborers making carpets, tying knots with their little hands. And if you look closely at the picture, you'll see that her hands are all rough and shaped, and her fingers are practically deformed by doing this work. Next. This boy is a brick worker in India. There are 60 to 115 million child laborers in India. At least 15 million of them work as bonded laborers. This means that they're put into servitude by generally their parents or their family to pay a family debt. Children who are sold into this debt work very long hours and for many years to pay it off. Next. Here's another brick worker in India. It is work in mining and construction, which is the most hazardous for children, and with a very high rate, 25% suffering major injuries. Next. According to the ILO, in surveys of countries, where countries that did serious surveys of working children, working children whose work is stressful is 50%, who come home from work exhausted is 60%, and who have no day off or free time is 80%. Next. Here's a stone quarry worker in India. Although most girls actually work as domestic servants, usually in a bonded labor situation where they often suffer sexual abuse as well. Next. This boy is a plastic bag seller in an Acapulco street market in Mexico. Many children, of course, earn their livings just simply on the street. Next. This is a metal worker in India, and in this place, dozens of children and adults crowd into a small block building and make cups, saucers, and other tableware. The air is hot and dusty, filled with fine grit from aluminum, brass, or stainless steel. The noise level, of course, exceeds occupational standards. Next. When we think of child labor in this country, we think of the mills in New England or in the South during the Industrial Revolution, or in the late 19th century, actually. This child is a spinner in a textile mill in Augusta, Georgia in 1909. By 1912, due to broad exposure of child labor throughout the country, more than 30 states in the United States had passed laws against it. But it has to be said today that we're living off the backs of child labor globally, as represented in the U.S. trade balance deficit. Next. Now, we can just do a very simple proof of this. Take the textile and garment worker industry. What does it mean if you can go to Kmart, which I have done, and buy a little t-shirt for your child, not that little, right? A medium-sized t-shirt for your child that costs $3. Now think about how that's possible. First there's the cotton, then the production of cloth out of the cotton, then the piecework to make the t-shirt, then the shipping, and all along there's a markup, plus the retail markup of Kmart itself. Now how can that shirt cost $3? Well, it turns out a lot of clothes that you see that are made in the Dominican Republic or made here or made there are really secretly made in Bangladesh. And because this is the cheapest outsource place in the world for textile and clothing manufacturers. They just sew on the labels to made from the other country. So that some entrepreneur or whatever in Dominican Republic is outsourcing to Bangladesh, and then that comes to the United States to Kmart. Now, what does this actually mean? So let's take the average hourly wage of the unionized garment worker in 1970, which was $8.71. And now let's today look at his wage, hourly wage of a presumably unionized worker in the garment industry in New York or something, and in constant $1970 dollars, his average wage today is $8.07. Okay? Next. Now, we also know that alongside him in New York City are the whole city is dotted with sweatshops filled with illegal immigrants, and illegal sweatshops they are, where people are doing piecework or doing work on making these things by lower, illegally, and their average wage is between 75 cents and $2, or for an average of $1.37. And I'm not going to even bother to put that in constant 1970 dollar terms, right, dollars. But the average wage of a child working in a garment factory in Bangladesh is 3 cents an hour. And what that buys at the end of the day, of a long day, is something to eat, so that the child can get up the next day and work another long day again for something to eat. And you know, and I know, and everybody knows, that is slavery. That is slavery. Now, the AFL-CIO rightly argues that this is globalization, and it is bringing down the wages and the standard of labor throughout the world. And that is correct. And they want to impose sanctions on countries which have child labor. Well, okay, child labor should be wiped out. They should be in school. But what are we supposed to do? Then go to the Bangladesh little girl or child and say, well, you can't eat anymore? So it doesn't work to just simply attack child labor per se, unless we are going to replace globalization with a system that permits that child to go to school, and that permits that child to eat, and that permits that child to live a human life. And if we don't take that responsibility, then all of our self-righteous discussion about child labor is just another form of murder. Now, the next thing that is going on with our children is that we are having increasing numbers of orphans. Next. There are 10 million AIDS orphans in Africa, or there will be very soon. The issue on this is that we really have to, we want to be honest, we have to ask ourselves, why is it that AIDS has coursed through Africa and continues to course through Africa, but it hasn't really hit white suburban America in the same way? Is that because we have better sexual practices here? You know, I don't think so. But it is running through Africa because the population is already physically depleted, because everybody there has immune systems that are already working double overtime. And this is leaving millions of orphans in their wake, in the wake of this, and the extended families in Africa are reaching a point where they can no longer take in these children. But these AIDS orphans do not stand a good chance of going to school. Next. Another group of children who do not stand a good chance of going to school are the 14 million children who live in camps for refugees or the internally displaced in the world today. These are an extreme example of children who were Rwandan Hutu children who were in Eastern Congo in 1997. These children, I presume, were really probably killed before they died of starvation. in the war to revive Leopold's ghost in the Congo. Next. Now, war really brings about the most extreme suffering for children, and it is now estimated that 1/3 of all war casualties in the globe today are children. And in the decade of the 1990s, 10 million children were killed, not just injured, but killed by war. We all know the story of Peter Pan and Wendy and the lost boys. Well, these are the real lost boys. These are 12,000 boys in southern Sudan who trekked for 4 years in that area, unaccompanied by adults, until they finally arrived in Kenya, where they were taken in by, I assume, the UN. But a lot of these boys were subsequently recruited, particularly by John Garang, into the Sudanese People's Liberation Army. But this just gives you an idea of what war does. Next. These are children, street children in Calcutta. Street children are those who generally don't have families or refuge and seek their living on the streets by themselves. As a rule, any child over a certain age who cannot be fed at home will just simply leave the home and take to the streets. There's a movie that you can see called Salaam Bombay about street children in that city. Many of the street children are AIDS orphans. So, for example, in Zambia, 200,000 children are street children in a population of 9 million. That is to say, 2%, more than 2% of the population are street children, which would be the equivalent of 5.5 million American children living in the streets. I'm going to just read a description of given by a foundation that works in Calcutta. The problems that street children face on streets of Calcutta are many and varied. Problems such as vulnerability because of lack of security and protection, which without these can cause physical, psychological, and social problems for the child. Also, they lack the basis for survival, such as food, money, shelter, clothes, health care. The children seem to be constantly struggling to make ends meet. That means they're hungry. They also suffer from the cold and the rain in winter, and of course, all sorts of insects and mosquito bites. They run into problems of abuse of all kinds and suffer from low self-esteem and from many illnesses and ailments because of the environment they live in. The introduction of the illicit drug trade in Calcutta has added to their problems. Of course, we have this problem in the United States today, particularly in inner cities, children who basically live on the street in gangs, and these are the people in our own country that we have turned our backs on. There does not appear to be a figure for the number of street children in the world today. Next. Another group of children that aren't able to go to school generally are the 1 million child prostitutes who, for example, live in Asia alone. And the number is increasing in Africa and other countries. In Thailand, in the decimated rural areas of this country, it is the norm that every girl child is going to be sent to a city and work a certain period of time before she is married as a prostitute to earn money for the family. Next. Well, this shows the problem that we have in our own country on this score. Next. Another group that's not going to school are child soldiers. This is a child soldier in Liberia. And the most criminal aspect of what the world under Gore's globalization has done to the world's children is the rise of the phenomenon of the child soldier. There are 300,000 child soldiers in active duty today. This is really represents the total destruction of the child's soul. Child soldiers are ferocious fighters and take orders easily since they are malleable and extremely psychologically vulnerable. Most child soldiers are orphans. Some join the ranks of the army because they seek protection and food, and others are forcibly recruited in the latter case. Most of those forcibly recruited have watched their own parents be killed. Thus, any child who enters into such an insurgency as a child soldier is generally already in a completely traumatized and desperate state. Next. These are two twins who gained extreme notoriety in Burma. They're members of the Karen National Union, and they led a raid on a hospital and took it over for a period of time. The child soldier is a ruthless killer because and gets a total ego thrill and high off the power of destroying life. Next. This is a child from the Revolutionary United Front in Sierra Leone who was taken prisoner. In this, the RUF, the Revolutionary United Front, distributes cocaine to its child fighters. As one commander told an AFP reporter, he was talking about how he had, there they would mutilate people. He said, well, that he had cut off 40, he said. He said he cut hands, captured and killed countless civilians in a town. There were so many, he said. He was not at all remorseful. He said the fighters were often high in cocaine, with doses varying according to the intensity of the operation. The children, the women, they were all responsible. We cut them and attacked them so they will not be involved in politics. Well, what is this monster? Who is he? Well, it turned out that the RUF had killed his mother, brothers, and sisters. They killed them, he said. Then they said I must go to the war front, so I did. Now come back to the United States. Next. To the same kind of affluent suburban neighborhood I was talking about earlier, to a place like Columbine. Here in the United States, we are witnessing the destruction of the souls of our children, but not through a process of extreme deprivation and traumatization. But rather, our culture is producing the equivalent of child soldiers through the mass media. Since the cultural shift of the 1960s, when we turned our backs on the children of the world, why should we not be surprised to find a generation later that our children are killing each other? The question of why we should help others outside of ourselves has now become the question of, well, why shouldn't we kill them? What values are left? Why should we be surprised if the selfishness and cynicism of 25 years ago running rampant is now turned into violent nihilism? Neither the radical environmentalism of Al Gore nor the neoconservatism of the Republican Party offers any pathway out of the profound moral crisis our society faces, because both of them are based on the same cynicism about the nature of man and the same selfishness that has brought us to this precise point. And we have to face the fact that when we turned our backs on the world and our responsibility to it, we set ourselves on the path of our own self-destruction. And since we've agreed to no longer care about the world except when the media gives us permission to do so, we are in a state of total ignorance. The fear is so great to know that even good people in the United States are terrified to face the suffering that goes on among millions of people in the world every day. They shield themselves from such suffering by saying that these other people don't really feel the same way we do. Next. But this is simply not the case. Next. We have the policies on hand, and we have the means to change the world so that every child has the opportunity to develop himself fully as a human being. We need the political will, which is nothing more than determination and courage based on love of humanity. Next. Only by taking on this responsibility again can we save our own children. And in this revival of the true mission of the United States, we must mobilize our own youth. We have to say to them in all humility, we have left you a wreck. We have left you holding the bag, and it is up to your generation now to rebuild the world out of the rubble heap that has been left by the 20th century. It is your generation which can create a world in which every child has the opportunity to live a full life, where no child is trashed. Next. That is what we must do. And if we have the commitment and are determined to take that responsibility, then this country may have a future again. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Our next speaker is John Hoeffel on the subject, Prosperity for Some, Tragedy for All.
Years ago, Lyndon LaRouche observed that were aliens to visit the planet Earth and see what was going on in our derivatives market, they would write us off as a planet gripped by insanity. In the intervening years, that insanity, like derivatives, has spread like a disease, infecting the far reaches of the global financial system and the minds of our fellow humans. Today, money has become an obsession with tens of millions of Americans. Not money in general, not her money, not his money, but my money. Those who have it are obsessed with keeping it and adding to their pile, and those who don't have it are obsessed with getting some. What's the most popular show on television? Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? It's such a big hit that it spawned a whole series of copycats. Greed, for one, and even Who Wants to Marry a Multimillionaire? Now, what's the state of mind of a man who would pick a wife from among the contestants on a TV show? And what's the state of mind of a woman who would enter a contest to marry some guy she never met just because he's rich? And what about the states of mind of the tens of millions of viewers who have made such freak shows so popular? If you've ever wondered how entire societies can go insane, like the Netherlands with the tulip bubble, just look around, because we're living in such a period right now. This is a genuine world historic mania. The global financial system has become a giant casino run by the international financial oligarchy as a way to separate the little people from their money. But that's just a part of it. The real aim of these oligarchs, or perhaps garks for short, since we don't want to treat them too much respect, is to destroy the nation states and their populations and take the world back to the feudal days when the sun never set on the queen's slaves. Now, this requires a bit of trickery, since the nation state is a vastly superior form of social organization, at least when it functions properly. As Benjamin Franklin warned, a republic, if you can keep it. To beat the United States, the garks have to destroy it from within, which means dumbing down enough of the population to prevent it from functioning as a citizenry. Get enough people to turn their backs on reason, and the nation ceases to function. One of the ways this is done is through greed, through my money. Anyone with any sense knows that the world and the U.S. is being increasingly divided between the haves and the have-nots. Some are horrified by this on moral grounds, and some are just horrified at the thought that they may not make the cut, that they will be losers rather than winners, as if one can win from the destruction of civilization. But by most accounts, meaning the reports from the oligarchy's propaganda outlets and the salesmen trying to lure your money into the bubble, the world economy has never been in better shape, thanks mainly to the wonderful growth in the United States over the last few years. After all, according to Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan, the biggest problem we have is keeping the growth under control, keeping the economy from overheating. And then there's the silly debate about what to do with the non-existent budget surplus. Do we pay down the debt, cut taxes, put it into Social Security? Well, since there is no surplus, we might as well do all of it. On the international front, they claim that our biggest problem is that the rest of the world is not following our lead, is not generating enough growth themselves. We're getting tired, Greenspan says, of carrying the bulk of this expansion alone. Now, that's an interesting concept. We're getting tired of making all the money ourselves, and we wish others would take some of these profits off our hands. Right. If you believe that, I have a bridge to sell. Just look under Brooklyn on eBay. Now, what Greenspan knows, but what won't dare say, is that the U.S. is sitting at the center, meaning ground zero, of the biggest financial bubble in history, a bubble which is becoming more unstable by the day and which requires constant attention and an increasing amount of money to keep it from popping. Somewhere out there in oligarch land is a command center which constantly monitors the bubble and dispatches the equivalent of SWAT teams to the scenes of financial disasters. Hello, 911, this is Wall Street. We just lost $1 trillion in the derivatives market. Calm down, sir. We'll be right there. Then the whole system swings into action, with central banks supplying money and guarantees, manipulating the markets to cover up those pesky losses before they have to be reported on somebody's books. That's the way the system works these days. One or more of the players, big players, gets into trouble. And they tend to get into trouble in packs, since they all do basically the same thing. And the keepers of the bubble step in to drive the markets back in line with the big players' derivative bets. All of the rules are designed to protect the power of the oligarchy against the power of nations. When Travelers and Citicorp announced their merger, everyone on Wall Street and everyone in Washington knew that it was illegal, but no one did anything. Well, actually, that's not true. Congress did do something. They changed the law repealing Glass-Steagall and effectively legalized the merger. Now, these financiers clearly consider themselves above the law, which makes sense. If you're out to destroy nation states, you're certainly not going to subject yourself to them. Ask about the repeal of Glass-Steagall. American International Group Chairman Hank Greenberg boasted to the Wall Street Journal that the change in the law was irrelevant. Most financial companies have been doing what they wanted in any event, Greenberg bragged. Now, the Department of Justice seems to agree. The DOJ has for years used federal conspiracy laws to nail both the innocent and the guilty. Yet when the chairman of Travelers and Citicorp held a press conference to publicly announce their intent to break federal law, which is a clear violation of federal conspiracy statutes, the press conference alone was a violation of the law, the Justice Department did nothing. Now, this is the same Justice Department that never met a black elected official it didn't want to indict, and which threw Lyndon LaRouche and several of his associates in jail for daring to tell the truth. We didn't break the law, we got nailed anyway. The banks did break the law, and the Department of Justice did nothing at all. So that makes it pretty clear who runs the Department of Justice. They work for Wall Street. Look what happened to the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, the CFTC, when it suggested that it might take another look at regulating over-the-counter derivatives. It got smashed. Smashed to the point where it is now wandering around Washington like a eunuch, telling anyone who will listen that it will never bother the derivatives market again. That the CFTC was right, and that many of today's derivatives deals are illegal under U.S. law, as the derivatives dealers and their regulators admit, made no difference at all. Merton Miller, the Nobel Prize-winning economist and member of the board of the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, put it succinctly. The CFTC, he said, didn't realize they were working for us. They thought they were in business for themselves. What fools. They thought they were regulators. The moral, or the immoral, of this story is clear. When the law interferes with the money, the law gives way. The markets, not the nation, are sovereign in their worldview. So what is all this propaganda protecting, and why are such brutal measures considered necessary? The size of this bubble is staggering. We estimate that there are somewhere around $300 trillion in financial claims outstanding worldwide, including derivatives, stocks, bonds, and other forms of debt, both on balance sheet and off. Using the best figures available, which isn't saying much, we calculate that the annual financial turnover now exceeds $1 quadrillion a year. That's 1,000 trillion, or roughly 100 times the level of world trade. Now, I would have put world trade on this graph, but you wouldn't have been able to see it without a magnifying glass. Now, when most people think of trade, they think of physical goods, such as oil, food, cars, and the like. But that's old economy, industrial age thinking. We're in what the experts call the new economy, where trade in physical goods is largely irrelevant. In the new economy, we trade money and information. And of course, most of the information is about money. Back in ancient times, you know, like the 1960s and 1970s, most of the dollars which exchanged hands between the U.S. and the rest of the world were related to trade in merchandise. Back then, 70% or more of the foreign exchange, 70% or more of the foreign exchange of dollars was connected to trade in physical goods. But today, U.S. merchandise trade accounts for only about 0.5% of global dollar foreign exchange trading. Over 99% of all foreign exchange trading is now due to speculation of one form or another. And foreign exchange speculation accounts for only about 1/4 of the total derivatives market, with the real action occurring in the interest rate sector, which means bonds. Now, the effect of this shift in the U.S. economy from being the breadbasket of the world in terms of both agriculture and industrial production into what is euphemistically called a service economy can be seen in our growing dependence upon foreign goods. Where we once exported our bounty to the world, raising both our own standard of living and that of the nations to whom we sold the machinery and infrastructure to make themselves more productive, we now have to import to make up the shortfall in our own production. We import food from countries where people are starving, while our own farmers go bankrupt at record rates. We move manufacturing facilities to countries where labor is cheap, destroying both our own productivity and our labor force at the same time. We are cannibalizing our nation and destroying the world through globalization. But hey, big deal. Who needs a physical economy when we have a stock market? This is the new economy at work. The pride of Wall Street and the world. Since the Dow broke 4,000 points in early 1995, it has been going virtually straight up, with a few bumps along the way. All of today's fluctuations, which we watch with such rapt attention, are occurring at the very top of this big mountain. When the Dow drops 10% or more, the experts call it a correction. It's just a minor fluctuation. A real correction would be more like Mount St. Helens, blowing the top of this virtual mountain to smithereens. Now still, until that correction occurs, this is a money machine, which, in the slippery words of Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan, creates wealth. And what wealth? The value of the stock traded on U.S. stock markets has skyrocketed in recent years, growing by nearly $13 trillion in the 1990s. At the end of the go-go 1980s, the stock market cap was just under $4 trillion. When it comes to blowing bubbles, the decade of the 80s was a wimp. In the 90s, we got serious. That this growth occurred without any comparable growth in the real economy is not a problem, since, according to the leading economist of the new economy, this disconnection between the financial and physical economies is a good thing because it insulates each from problems in the other. Now, once you accept that brilliant concept, you can start to make the serious money, which in the stock market means the internet. Take America Online, for example. At the end of 1999, AOL was the 10th largest company on the New York Stock Exchange in terms of market capitalization, right behind Hank Greenberg's We Do Whatever We Want AIG. Now, AOL stock has taken a bit of a hit since it's announced it was buying Time Warner, a deal which will basically double it in size. So its market cap is now down to about $126 billion from a peak of $210 billion. Even so, that's more than Ford and General Motors combined. Now that's pretty impressive, considering that Ford and GM both make a lot more money than AOL. But in today's virtual economy, what the company does is irrelevant. It's what the company's stock price does that counts. Companies which make real products are actually at a disadvantage, since all that production costs money. What that means is there's less money available for the shareholders. Now, the smartest way, the investment geniuses insist, is to buy stocks on margin. You put some money down and you borrow the rest. That enables you to buy a lot more stock than you could buy if you had to pay cash up front. Now, the debt shown on the graph is only part of the picture, since some of the more determined investors take out second mortgages on their homes or personal loans or even credit card cash advances to buy stock. After all, what's 20% interest when you can buy stocks that go up hundreds, even thousands of percent a year? Who can afford to pass up that kind of profit? Of course, more than half the stocks traded on the U.S. exchanges lost value during 1999, with the major indices being held up by a relative handful of companies. So if you're going to bet your house on the stock market, you'd better pick very carefully. Now, there's an old saying about statistics, which is that if your head is on fire and your feet are frozen, on average, you're doing just fine. When in fact, you're dying, if you're not already dead. Now, keep that in mind when you hear about how wealthy we all are today, because the wealth is not distributed equally. I hope I didn't shock anybody. A recent study by ER's Richard Freeman shows that the rich are indeed getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. It turns out, surprise, surprise, the rich own most of the stock and therefore get most of the stock income. The wealthiest 1% in the United States owns 42% of all stocks. The next 9% owns another 42%. Meaning that 84% of all U.S. stocks are owned by the wealthiest 10% of the population. The remaining 90% of the population gets to share the rest. So the top 10% gets the lion's share of that $13 trillion in stock value created by Mr. Greenspan's bubble. And they get to keep more of it thanks to the cuts in the capital gains taxes. That's one of the reasons why the top 20% of the population now has more total income than the bottom 80%. It gets even worse when you compare the wealthiest 1% to the poorest 20%. The median income of the top 1% of the population was $215,000 a year in 1997. And that more than doubled to $472,000 a year last year. The bottom 20% of the income spectrum was not quite so lucky. Their median income actually fell from $10,000 in 1997 to $8,600 in 1999. Imagine trying to support a family on $8,600 a year or less. Chances are you wouldn't be on a first-name basis with the BMW salesman. Which brings us to, as they say, the bottom line on this winners and losers scorecard, net wealth. In the 1980s, being a millionaire was a big deal, but today, millionaires are commonplace. Not quite a dime a dozen, but getting close. According to one recent study, there were 7.9 million millionaires in the U.S. at the end of 1998, compared to 1.6 million in 1990. But in an era when you can become an instant millionaire by winning a TV game show or a lottery, millionaires are passé. To make it really big, you have to be a billionaire, of which 237 were created in the U.S. in the 1990s, compared to only 13 in the 1980s. So while on average we're all getting richer, the average is meaningless, since 1% of the population owns 35% of the wealth in the country, and the next 9% owns 33%. That's two-thirds of the wealth in the hands of the richest 10%, leaving the 90% of us to fight over the remaining third of the pie, much of which is hot air anyway. Now, of course, these nouveau riches are not without problems of their own. After all, having the nicest stateroom on the ship is small consolation when the ship is sinking in a sea of debt. During the 1990s, according to the official figures, the U.S. economy went over $3 in debt for every dollar rise in GDP, ending the decade with more than $25 trillion in combined government and private debt. Now, official figures, keep in mind, means what they admit to publicly. The truth is always worse. The growth of the debt during the decade, $12 trillion or so, depending upon the final figures, offsets nearly all of the $13 trillion gain in the stock market. So all of that wealth that Alan Greenspan created actually is just debt. But while the stock gains are concentrated among the rich, the debt is not, at least not when it comes to household debt. According to a 1997 survey by the Fed, the bottom 90% of U.S. families owed 71% of the family debt. That's what happens when you have to live off credit cards and other borrowing to cover an inadequate income. Living beyond their means, many people are counting on their mutual funds, their pension funds, and their equity in their homes to bail them out. But these hopes are fruitless. The value of mutual funds is skyrocketing, rising more than fivefold in the 1990s. But that rise, due to the rise in the stock market as a whole, will disappear a lot faster than it grew. The same holds true for pension funds, especially the private funds. When Mount St. Helens blows, so does the safety net. But many people won't even make it that far. More than 10 million people filed for bankruptcy in the 1990s, double the number who filed in the 1980s. It got so bad that the default started to hurt the credit card banks. So Congress, in its infinite wisdom, stepped in and acted and made it harder to file for bankruptcy. But people are desperate, filled with the frightening reality that they're being pushed over the edge of the abyss. This desperation leads many to seek the big score, to get theirs before they go under. People are gambling in many ways, from betting their future on the stock market to lotteries and casinos. There's also the problem of cultural pessimism. Prior to the launch of the counterculture in the late 1960s, most people believed that if they worked hard all their lives, they would leave a better world for their children. Their fellow man was their ally in this great work. That is still possible. We represent that potential. But how many people believe it? With the rise of the counterculture, many among us turned our backs on reason and the scientific and technological breakthroughs which flow from reason and adopted a belief structure heavily contaminated with pagan superstitions. We turned our back on nuclear power and its potential to revolutionize our economy, a mistake for which we pay heavily in ways well beyond our electricity bills. We turned our back on pesticides such as DDT condemning millions of people in poorer nations to starvation and disease. We turned our back on water management to the point where we're tearing down dams and letting the rivers run free. We've turned our health care over to HMOs, which place a higher priority on meeting the demands of Wall Street than they do in keeping us alive. By turning our backs on progress, we have created a world economy which is in decline, in which resources are becoming scarcer. And when the pie starts to shrink, the fights start to break out. The people who used to be your allies when the pie was growing now become your competitors. For each and every piece they get, there's less for you. A Hobbesian each against all dynamic sets up along racial, religious, geographic, and political lines, anything which differentiates one individual or group from another. And while we're busy trying to steal from each other, the oligarchy is robbing us all blind. While the suckers are pouring their money into the financial markets, the oligarchs and their proxies are grabbing physical assets as fast as they can. They know the bubble is doomed, and they're seizing control of raw materials, food supplies, energy, communications, and other essentials to give them the power to dominate the world after the crash. They're going after post-crash income streams. Whoever can pay will have to turn to the oligarchs for the necessities of life. If you can pay, you'll pay through the nose. If you can't pay, tough. You're just a useless eater, and you will be left to die. If the oligarchy gains control after a financial collapse, the result would be a new dark age. As Lynn says, if we don't prevent that from happening, it's going to mean hell on earth for at least decades to come. The alternative to this looming nightmare is the sovereign republic, which, when it adheres to its principles, is politically and economically vastly superior to the empire. As the young United States proved, the republic is more than a match for the empire when it harnesses its power for the good. And don't make the mistake of thinking that the danger is somewhere far off in the future. This collapse is not something which will happen somewhere down the road. The system is breaking apart as we speak. The events of the past 3 years, from Asia, Russia, and Brazil to the current problems in the bonds and the derivatives market, represent the death throes of the bubble. The shocks are coming faster and harder than ever before, and every successful rescue only makes the system more unstable. The problem, as Lynn's triple curve collapse function shows, is that we have reached the point where it simply isn't possible to keep the system going much longer. The combination of printing money like crazy while cannibalizing the physical economy is inherently hyperinflationary, making the money virtually worthless. But if they don't keep pumping money into the system, the value of the assets in the bubble will fall from their stratospheric levels back to Earth, resulting in a chain reaction deflationary collapse. Caught between a hyperinflationary blowout and a deflationary collapse, the oligarchs are on a worldwide rampage against nation states, spreading war and chaos everywhere they can and running the risk of triggering World War III. None of those options, hyperinflation, deflation, or war, are acceptable. So let us organize the only alternative, Lyndon LaRouche's New Bretton Woods, and save civilization.
Thank you, John. Many of you will remember John from the Storm Over Asia videotape, one of the items which is available at the literature table in the back. I think John got an Emmy for Best Supporting Actor for that, didn't you, John? If Mount St. Helens is about to go over here. Okay, but to remind you that the literature table is still open and will be open after the session. Videotapes, EIR special reports, back issues of EIR, price to move, get them while you can. And those listening to this panel on the internet, on the webcast, can contact us through the website. Our final speaker on tonight's panel is Jeffrey Steinberg, counterintelligence editor of EIR, author of the lead article in the package on the destruction of the nation state in the recent issue of EIR. And Jeff will speak to us on the architects of the assault on the nation state.
That live performance of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony occurred on Christmas Day, December 25th, 1989, at the Schauspielhaus in Berlin. Orchestras and choruses from Dresden, Leningrad, London, New York, East Berlin, West Berlin, Paris, and Munich participated in the performance, which was attended, as you could see, by tens of thousands of people, both inside the hall and lining the plaza where the Berlin Wall just months before had stood. Admittedly, this was not the greatest performance of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony ever made. And this was by no means a paid advertisement for the conducting of Leonard Bernstein. But nevertheless, Schiller's Ode to Joy was heard around the world, reflecting a spontaneous but lawful surge of cultural optimism. The communist system that had been one half of the Cold War division of the world for 50 years was in the process of crumbling through a revolution in which demonstrators carried candles rather than machetes and AK-47s. Just 14 months earlier, Lyndon LaRouche had astonished an audience in the same city when he declared that Germany could be peacefully reunited within a brief period of time through the launching of a Food for Peace plan for the economic transformation of Poland and the other suffering nations of the East. LaRouche's forecast of the short-term demise of the Soviet Empire, which he first presented after Soviet Prime Minister Yuri Andropov rejected President Ronald Reagan's offer to jointly develop and deploy a global shield against offensive nuclear weapons, had played out on the streets of Dresden, Leipzig, Prague, Warsaw, Bratislava, Gdansk, and countless other towns and villages all across Eastern Europe. Yet paradoxically, even as the bricks of the Berlin Wall were being hauled off as souvenirs of a nightmare past, Lyndon LaRouche was already in federal prison in Rochester, Minnesota, the victim of a vile travesty of justice launched by Henry Kissinger, among others, and fully sanctioned by the new President of the United States, George Bush, the father of the present wannabe Republican nominee, George W. Bush. Alfred Herrhausen, the German banker, who had in his own way embraced the idea of an ambitious economic reconstruction of the East, had been assassinated just weeks before the Berlin concert by professional assassins dispatched from London. Those heady days in late 1989 marked an inflection point in modern history. Although British visionaries of world government and the breakup of the nation-state system, from H.G. Wells to Lord Bertrand Russell, had set forth their insane utopian ideas during the early decades of the 20th century, first World War II and then the Cold War blocked even the most die-hard one-world oligarchs from launching their final offensive to wipe out the last vestiges of republicanism. The simple fact was, so long as there was a potential for a strategic military conflict between NATO and the Warsaw Pact, the nation-state system could not be wholly abandoned. All but the most insane among the international financial oligarchy and their brain trusts recognized that the nation-state system represented the only system of government, the only organization of society capable of marshaling the physical and creative resources for general war, the same resources needed for economic development, and particularly needed for a war that might involve the exchange of intercontinental ballistic missiles with nuclear warheads. With the fall of the Berlin Wall, the breakup of the Warsaw Pact, and then the collapse of the Soviet Union itself, the last impediments were removed for the unleashing of a full-scale war of extinction against the nation-state system. Now, this was obviously only one side of the story. For the handful of true Republican statesmen on the scene, led by individuals like Lyndon LaRouche, the end of the Soviet Empire represented a great moment of opportunity when the Iron Curtain that had blocked the integration of the Eurasian continent was removed, and suddenly there were no barriers to the economic development of the Eurasian landmass from the Atlantic coast to the Pacific Far East. This idea of a new Silk Road crisscrossing Eurasia was an international Republican project dating back to the era of President Abraham Lincoln. The mid-19th century construction of the transcontinental railroad across the United States, which consolidated the continental republic in North America, developing agro-industrial corridors, building new cities on the plains, demonstrating the boundlessness of man's dominion over nature, was the standpoint from which American allied republicans in Russia, China, Japan, France, Germany, Ireland, Ibero-America, built the Trans-Siberian Railroad, the Berlin to Baghdad Railroad, the Paris to Vladivostok Railroad. The locomotives that ran across the Trans-Siberian Railroad were manufactured by the Baldwin Company in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Similar rail and other great infrastructure projects were launched in Africa and in South and Central America during the closing decades of the 19th century. It was in reaction to this global Republican offensive that the British Crown, led by the so-called Prince of the Isles, Edward Albert, later King Edward VII, assassinated U.S. President William McKinley and later launched World War I. From his jail cell, Lyndon LaRouche, along with his international collaborators, revived those 19th century Republican ideas, first through the call for the development of a productive triangle stretching from Paris to Berlin to Warsaw to serve as the industrial heartland for a new Marshall Plan for the East. Later, LaRouche expanded this idea into the call for the revival of the new Silk Road, spanning the Eurasian continents, stretching into Africa, across the Bering Straits into North and then South America. These proposals were consistent with his earlier Strategic Defense Initiative and Operation Juarez efforts from the 1970s and 80s, but reflected the new opportunities posed by the shifting strategic situation. The British oligarchy, already bent on accelerating the destruction of the nation-state system, responded to the threat represented by these LaRouche proposals with a vengeance. By 1990, 1 year after the fall of the wall, the Balkans were already aflame. Lord Peter Carrington and Lord David Owen were the British proconsuls responsible for igniting and spreading a Balkan Holocaust. The ethnic cleansing genocide that proceeded in the Balkans over the next decade was not merely aimed at creating a geopolitical choke point to stymie Eurasian development, although that was clearly one objective. By encouraging and manipulating the outbreak of brutality, unseen in Europe since the end of World War II, the psychological warfare mavens at the London Tavistock Institute and other locations sought to break that spirit of cultural optimism that we saw a few moments ago on the screen, triggered by the Velvet Revolutions of 1989, and replace it with graphic images of brutal inhumanity, so bestial as to break the spirit of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam for the majority of people around the world. Some referred to the nightly news clips of the genocide, the razed cities, the refugee concentration camps as the CNN effect. Only by breaking the human spirit, by erasing the cultural optimism, could the full disintegration of the nation-state system be achieved. In Nietzsche's words, man abandoned by God. 5 years after the Berlin concert celebrating the fall of the wall, through the performance of the works of Beethoven and Schiller, a very different, yet equally optimistic concert, from which you just saw an excerpt, was performed at the bombed-out remnant of the National Library in Sarajevo. Internationally renowned musicians, Zubin Mehta, Jose Carreras, Ruggiero Raimondi, joined with the Sarajevo Philharmonic Orchestra and the choir of the Cathedral of Sarajevo to perform Mozart's Requiem. It was, in effect, an act of defiance against the British oligarchy. Even the producers of the widely circulated video of the concert understood at least this much of its significance. They wrote, quote, "Performed in memory of all who have died in Sarajevo's tragic conflict and staged in the charred shell of the once grand National Library, the immortal Requiem becomes a celebration of the indomitable human spirit. It is mesmerizing, profoundly moving, and ultimately uplifting concert that will be remembered for years to come." Nevertheless, by the time that the Sarajevo concert took place, other parts of the world had also been engulfed by similar war and brutality, instigated in every instance from London and allied capitals. By 1991, under the thumb of Margaret Thatcher, President George Bush had launched Operation Desert Storm against Iraq to make the world safe for his so-called New World Order. If anyone needs an explanation of why the United States and the world will not likely survive as we know it if George W. Bush becomes President of the United States, just fix your memory on some of the highlights of the first George Bush presidency. Desert Storm. The image of American soldiers blaring punk rock music into the Vatican Embassy in Panama City to capture Noriega. 20,000 American troops invading a country ostensibly to serve a single arrest warrant. The only difference between George Bush Sr. and George W. Bush is that if W. were to be placed into the White House, he'd probably not be able to pronounce the names of the countries he was destroying. By 1994 to 1995, the Great Lakes region of Africa had also been transformed into a killing field through the direct intervention of the British Crown in the person of Prince Philip and his World Wildlife Fund. Following the April 1994 assassinations of the presidents of Rwanda and Burundi as they were returning from an international conference, tribal and ethnic wars broke out throughout the Great Lakes region, all manipulated from London. The sheer acts of Hitlerian genocide, however, only fulfilled one facet of the British oligarchy's assault upon humanity. It did set off a process of population extermination, particularly targeted at the darker-skinned races, precisely as mandated by Bertrand Russell and Prince Philip, and codified by Henry Kissinger in the infamous National Security Memorandum 200, which claimed that population growth in the developing sector represented a national security threat to the United States. Let us not forget also that Vice President Al Gore, the other media-declared presidential front-runner, is a rabid advocate of the same radical population reduction policies. It's no coincidence that Gore, a protege of Prince Philip, has been instrumental in preventing the delivery of cheap AIDS medication to South Africa and other areas of the Third World, thus willfully accelerating the death rates. But this mass murder on a scale that would make Hitler blush failed to adequately attack the idea of the Republican nation-state system. Towards that goal, a slew of British Crown-sponsored propaganda fronts, from the Royal Institute for International Affairs at Chatham House in London, to the International Institute for Strategic Studies, also in London, to the Council on Foreign Relations in New York, launched a propaganda drive to savage the idea of the nation state. Much of it was conducted under the pretext of stimulating policy debate, but the cumulative effect has been an all-out war of words to wipe the idea of the nation state from the political lexicon. In the spring and summer of 1993, a pair of articles were published with much fanfare in the CFR's journal Foreign Affairs. First, Kenichi Ome, the director of the Japanese office of the international consulting firm McKinsey & Company, wrote a piece provocatively called The Rise of the Region State, which started out with the following fractured formulation. Quote, "The nation-state system has become an unnatural, even dysfunctional unit for organizing human activities and managing economic endeavors in a borderless world. It represents no genuine shared community of economic interests. It defines no meaningful flows of economic activity. In fact, it overlooks the true linkages and synergies that exist among often disparate populations by combining important measures of human activity at the wrong level of analysis." In other words, from now on, the nation state, don't go there. It's been written out of economics and politics on a worldwide scale. Ome argued for the elimination of the nation state altogether and its replacement by a combination of multilateral institutions like NAFTA, Maastricht, the United Nations, and the development of what he called, quote, natural local economic alliances, often based on common geographic or demographic interests, which can then interact directly with the global economy. In 1995, Ome expanded his original foreign affairs essay into a book that was published by Free Press under the even more provocative title, simply, The End of the Nation State. In the summer of 1993, the very next issue of Foreign Affairs published another article intended to greatly accelerate the assault on the nation-state system. Samuel Huntington, who had been Zbigniew Brzezinski's underling at the National Security Council during the Carter administration and had earlier penned the Trilateral Commission's 1975 Project Democracy Manifesto, The Crisis of Democracy, wrote an article titled The Clash of Civilizations. Huntington argued that in the post-Cold War world, nation-states no longer counted. What counted was a looming, inevitable, unstoppable clash of civilizations between what he called the West versus the rest. Quote, "The clash of civilizations will dominate global politics. The fault lines between civilizations will be the battle lines of the future." And where did he say those fault lines would emerge? Huntington honed in on the Balkans. Quote, "As the ideological divisions of Europe have disappeared, the cultural division of Europe between Western Christianity on the one hand and Orthodox Christianity and Islam on the other has reemerged," unquote. The Huntington piece featured a map of Europe circa 1500, showing the religious fault lines running from north to south through the Baltics, the Ukraine, and the Balkans, dividing Yugoslavia. Quote, "In the Balkans, this line, of course, coincides with the historical boundary between the Habsburg and Ottoman empires. The peoples to the north and west of this line are Protestant or Catholic. They share the common experience of European history, feudalism, the Renaissance, the Reformation, the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, the Industrial Revolution. They're generally economically better off than the peoples of the East. The peoples of the East and the south of this line are Orthodox or Muslim. They historically belong to the Ottoman or Tsarist empires and were only lightly touched by the shaping events of the rest of Europe. The velvet curtain of culture has replaced the iron curtain of ideology as the most significant dividing line of Europe. As the events in Yugoslavia show, it is not only a line of difference, it is also at times a line of bloody conflict," unquote. Now, I found it particularly interesting that Huntington in this article chose to have a map of Europe showing all of these fault lines from the year 1500, at precisely the time that the Republican forces in Europe had launched the colonization project of North America precisely to create, here on the shores of this continent, a Republican bastion, an alternative to the wars among various rival financier and landed feudal oligarchies in the continent of Europe. This was something that Huntington completely wrote out of the equation. The United States itself, as the beacon of liberty, as the Republican instrumentality for spreading those ideas around the world, was simply ignored. Don't go there, it doesn't exist anymore. Forget any idea of natural law, universal principles of humanity. In the fractured world of Huntington, the future is defined by a revival of the religious and imperial wars of the pre-nation state epic. The big clash Huntington salivates over is the clash between the West and a combination of Islam and what he calls Confucian civilization. Now, Huntington's use of the term Confucian has absolutely nothing to do whatsoever with the great Chinese philosopher who was a contemporary of Socrates and Plato. It was his oh-so-polite way of saying, yellow peril, war with China. In effect, Huntington argued that the future survival of the West would depend on its ability to manipulate as many conflicts as possible between Islam and Orthodoxy, Islam and the, quote, Confucians in China, Islam and the Hindu culture, particularly in the Indian subcontinent. Huntington's piece, like Omé's earlier article, contributed further to the orchestrated, quote, debate about the nature of the post-nation state world. In 1996, Huntington's foreign affairs article reappeared in book length as The Clash of Civilizations and the Remaking of the World Order. By this time, a slew of other books and articles had been published, all arguing the same theme. The epoch of the nation state was over. A new world order would emerge from a prolonged period of war, chaos, and social unrest. Max Singer and Aaron Wildavsky, two American think tankers, wrote The Real World Order, Zones of Peace, Zones of Turmoil, in 1993, at the same time that the Omé and Huntington articles were coming out. They introduced the idea that the modern industrial states of North America, Western Europe, and Japan would remain relatively affluent and stable, while the rest of the world, particularly in the southern hemisphere, would go through generations of living hell, lasting perhaps for the next two centuries. This idea was stated in even more stark terms in a series of pieces published in Europe during the same time frame. In Italy, Lucio Caracciolo launched Limes magazine and sponsored a series of geopolitical seminars on the disintegration of Africa, Russia, and the Balkans. The term Limes referred to the wall that was built around Rome during the Imperium to ward off the savage hordes. Increasingly, Africa, parts of the Islamic world, particularly Central Asia, Caucasia, and even Latin America, were described as terra incognita, vast zones of lawlessness and devastation to be ruled by marauding gangs. With the nation-state written out of the future, the propagandists for this new global feudalism presented a number of alternative forms of governance to the nation-state. From November 13th through 19th, 1989, even prior to the concert and the full collapse of the Berlin Wall, leading figures from the Tavistock Institute and its offshoots gathered at the campus of Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio, to chart out a new world order built around what they called transnational non-governmental organizations, or NGOs. The conference was attended by psychiatrists, sociologists, and political activists from 44 countries. The proceedings were published in book form with an introduction by Tavistock psychologist Elise Boulding, in which she proclaimed that NGOs in the ensuing decades would fill the void created by the necessary and long overdue elimination of the nation-state system, a future that she wholeheartedly endorsed. Echoing an earlier Tavistock mandate, the conference participants were told that social scientists, psychiatrists, psychologists were responsible, above all others, for the growth of the new global consciousness to herald the rise of an international civil society to replace the nation state, which they proclaimed was the source of all of the evils of the world: overpopulation, depletion of natural resources, human rights violations, and the still looming threat of nuclear holocaust. Writing afterwards in the official publication of the Tavistock Institute, Human Relations, the conference co-chairs, Dr. David Copperwriter and Dr. William Passmore, declared that the NGOs, quote, represent a unique social invention of the postmodern, post-industrial, information-rich, and service-focused, globally linked world system. How's that for a mouthful of babble? Howard Perlmutter, professor of social architecture at the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania — I suppose that means buildings that are constructed out of piles of human corpses, although I haven't seen the definition written down anywhere. At that time, this man was the head of the American branch of the Tavistock Institute. He was at this conference, and he described it as well. He said, quote, "The central thesis of our recent work has been that we are seeing a paradigm shift in the social architecture of societal institutions around the world, which have as both a cause and a consequence the building of the planet's first global civilization." The psychobabble language aside, the conference specified a new global onslaught by the 20,000 plus NGOs loosely grouped around the United Nations organization to supplant and replace the role of the nation state, beginning in those areas of terra incognita where British-manipulated wars had already dismantled effective state involvement. Israeli military historian Martin Van Creewald was far more blunt in his 1991 book, The Transformation of War. His starting premise was the rapid disintegration of the nation-state system as the result of the failure of even powerful states like the United States to effectively defeat terrorism and other new and virulent forms of irregular warfare. Quote, "As the second millennium AD is coming to an end, the state's attempt to monopolize violence in its own hands is faltering. Brought face to face with the threat of terrorism, the largest and mightiest empires that the world has ever known have suddenly begun falling into each other's arms. The rise of low-intensity conflict may, unless it is quickly contained, end up destroying the state." Van Creewald singled out Russia, China, and India as three prime targets for disintegration. But he argued that even the United States would not long be immune to disintegration. Quote, "The United States is another large, multiracial society where weapons are widely available and that has a tradition of internal violence second to none. America's current economic decline must be halted, or else one day the crime that's rampant in the streets of New York and Washington, D.C. may develop into low-intensity conflict by coalescing along racial, religious, social, and political lines and running completely out of control," end of quote. Future wars, he argued, will be fought between gangs and police, religious fanatics, private mercenary armies hired by commercial interests, as was the case during the heyday of the British Empire, when the East India Company fielded a larger and more modern navy and army than the British Crown. The fall 1998 issue of Foreign Policy, published by the misnamed Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, was devoted to the topic outsourcing war. Picking up on Van Creewald's theme of the privatization of irregular warfare, the journal noted that in Africa, Latin America, and South Pacific areas, private raw material cartels and even weak governments had resorted to hiring private armies to stave off insurgencies and protect those pockets of territory that constituted vital areas of economic wealth: mines, plantations, oil fields. In these so-called failed states, the breakdown of all social order prevents even NGOs from filling the void. So in this case, it's a matter of hiring private mercenary armies, which, believe it or not, are predominantly from the British Commonwealth countries, South Africa and Britain itself. This vast outpouring of black propaganda about borderless worlds, globalization, terra incognita, Lemus, and irregular warfare all ignores one fundamental fact. There never has been, there is not now, and there never will be a form of society, of social organization, superior to the Republican nation-state system. Any other form of government, particularly under today's situation of financial crisis, irregular warfare, would simply mean a world driven by tyranny, genocide, and a new dark age. The challenge for us here today is see through the babble. Declare to your friends and neighbors that the emperor has no clothes, and resolve to fight for the survival of the nation-state system as if your life, the lives of your family, your children, your grandchildren, your neighbors depended on it, because indeed it does. And take heart in the fact that humankind was created with that indomitable spirit of optimism that we saw in some of the musical settings earlier in the presentation just now and last night. So humanity was not made to be destroyed by the oligarchy. And therefore, as Lyndon LaRouche has emphasized repeatedly, we're on the verge of their system being destroyed, blowing up, melting, disintegrating. And it's at those moments throughout history that we have seen humankind rise to the occasion, leadership emerge. In this case, the leadership already exists. The issue is simply the Pearl Harbor effect, as LaRouche has called it, setting in and the population waking up to their true human identity and realizing that we are many and they are few. Thank you.